Well, good evening and welcome to our second lecture of the Boice Center. And we appreciate you coming, making your way in the midst of the heat. If you remember the first lecture we had here, it was the snow and the inclement weather that we had. So we'll promise you one down the road that maybe will be a little more conducive to driving in or bearing the conditions of the heat. A couple announcements before we get started. First of all, during and after the lecture, you may text in a question. That doesn't mean to say you can't ask a question afterward, but you may text one in, and let me give you a number to text in. The number to text in is 267-251-7226. 267-251-7226. Also, just a reminder, the restrooms are out at the end of the sanctuary, down the steps and underneath the end of the sanctuary in the catacombs. And also, if you parked in South Street parking lot, don't forget to validate that ticket to get your parking for $5 rather than the higher price. We want to welcome you tonight, and our topic tonight is Inerrancy and Church History, 1800 all the way to the present. And we're pleased to have with us tonight no stranger to 10th. He's taught Sunday school classes. He's very active in the vocational ministry, and as well, just a good friend of many of us, Dr. Jeff Jew. Jeff, just to give you a background, received his BA from the University of California, Irvine, received his MDiv from Westminster Theological Seminary, and his PhD from the University of Aberdeen. His PhD dissertation, Joseph Mead and the Legacy of Millenarianism, has been published. He's also the author of numerous articles, as well as co-editing a number of other articles. He presently is the Associate Professor of Church History and Stephen Tong Associate Professor of Reform Theology at Westminster Theological Seminary. And he also carries the responsibility as the provost, just a new assignment, as the provost and executive vice president at Westminster Theological Seminary. He and his wife, Jane, are members of 10th Presbyterian Church. Let's pray as we do begin. Our Father, we thank you for bringing us here this evening. We're reminded that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And we pray that our minds as well as our hearts would be moved this evening as we explore this topic of inerrancy in church history. Bless this time together for those that are gathered here as well as those that will hear by webcast. And we thank you for the one that you've brought to us. We thank you for his study, for his love of you, for his leadership of the institution at Westminster Theological Seminary. And we pray that you would bless him and bless us as we learn together these important truths, we pray. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sure, I'm on. Yeah. It really is a privilege to be a part of this lecture series, inaugurating the Boice Center here at 10th Presbyterian Church, and especially to address a very, very important issue, the doctrine of inerrancy, which has been the theme then for our lecture series that began with Dr. Beal. And I know there's a lineup of a number of stellar speakers coming in to address this topic. George introduced the topic tonight as Church History 1800 to the Present. I hope not to disappoint many of you. We just don't have the time in about 45 minutes to cover 1800 to the present. So what I've done tonight is I've really focused us with a new title. You'll see it here. The Doctrine of Inerrancy, B.B. Warfield, and his dates are 1851 to 1921, and the Battle for the Bible. And primarily we'll be looking at then the 19th century, in which this issue became such a focal point for the church and for theologians as they wrestled through the doctrine of Scripture. Now let me begin with the definition. What is the doctrine of inerrancy? And we'll take it from J.I. Packard here, who has really summarized in a very succinct way for us. Inerrancy signifies the total truthfulness of a source of information that contains no mistakes. Let me read that again. Inerrancy signifies the total truthfulness of a source of information, the Bible, that contains no mistakes. Again, this is an important doctrine. I dare say it's one of the most important doctrines that the church has wrestled with in the last 250 years. It has been debated, it has been contested, and as a result, I would say it is one of, again, the most significant things that we need to understand as Christians even today. And the impact and the importance of the debates that have gone on over the last 200 years or so have still continued to have its influence and impact even today. Let me give you two examples. Two examples that come from the history of this church, 10th Presbyterian Church. Let me take you back to 1976. And I think there are many of you in this congregation here tonight who know this history even better than I do. In 1976, Dr. James Boice, along with R.C. Sproul, J.I. Packer, and other theologians, founded the International Council for Biblical Inerrancy. The stated purpose of this council was, quote, to take a united stand, elucidating, vindicating, and applying the doctrine of biblical inerrancy as an essential element of the authority of Scripture and a necessity for the health of the Church of God. Now, clearly, for the council, they perceived that the church, particularly in America, was moving away from this historic position on inerrancy. And one of the results of the work of this council that Dr. Boice led as the chairman of the council was to come up with what is really now the standard statement of inerrancy, the Chicago Statement of Inerrancy that they crafted. Another example, March 9th, 1980, the congregation of 10th voted to leave the United Presbyterian Church USA, what is today's mainline PCUSA. One of the reasons for the decision, as one elder put it, quote, Scripture no longer functions as the ultimate authority within the United Presbyterian Church. The authority is the human majority, the authority of the 51%. Looking at the history of the UPC, it is clear that by 1980, the doctrine of inerrancy was no longer a confessional or doctrinal standard within the denomination. Now you might say, what's the big deal? This doctrine of inerrancy that scholars and leaders like Dr. Boice and others devoted so much time to, crafting statements, defending and debating it, isn't this something that you theologians and biblical scholars like to talk about, splitting hairs, defining things so specifically? What does that have to do with us in the church day to day? Well, I think Dr. Boice put it well, referring to the doctrine of inerrancy when he stated, quote, I believe the churches will flounder and die if this is forgotten. And he was pointing directly to the life, the health, the vitality of the church depending upon this doctrine. And again, you might ask, well, if that's the case, that it's so important, what is this whole, if I go back one slide, to the title, Battle for the Bible? Why would Christians be fighting over something that Dr. Boice described as so vital for the church? Isn't this something we as Christians should all agree on? Isn't it something that we should all be convinced of and committed to as Christians? Why was there and why is there still this great battle over the Bible in which the doctrine of inerrancy is such an important component to that? Well, to understand this, we need to go a little further back in history, and I'm going to break the parameters of my assignment tonight and actually take us back to the 16th and early 17th century, from Calvin to Westminster, to a time and a place that was very, very different than what you and I have experienced today. The 16th and 17th century was a very different world, with a very different worldview for those in Europe at the time. Professor David Steinmetz of Duke University describes the centrality of the Bible during those centuries. He writes, the Bible was, in the fullest sense of the term, a 16th century book. It influenced European attitudes toward war and peace, the structure of civil government and the family, the process of human growth and development, theories of child rearing and education, as well as attitudes toward economic relations and policies of taxation. To summarize, what Dr. Steinmetz is saying is the Bible influenced everything in the world of the Europeans of the 16th and early 17th century. Why was that the case? First, I would say, is because they had a theocentric worldview. If you were living in Europe in the 16th and 17th century, you believed in God, and you believed that this God created everything, including yourselves, and that this God ordered the world, and that this God is involved actively in the world. Now, in the 16th and early 17th century, it did not matter if you were a Protestant, a Roman Catholic, a Muslim, or a Jew. This was your worldview. You understood there is a God, He created all things, and He is active in our world. Theocentric worldview, and all of life revolved around that worldview. Second, in the 16th and 17th century, there was an unquestioned commitment to supernaturalism. So it's not that just that there is a God, and He created all things, but this God is involved in the world and has in fact done supernatural things in the world because this God is intending to save us. And that the deeds of the Bible all demonstrate the supernatural character of God in the world through miracles and great deeds. And no one questioned that. Supernaturalism, absolutely. God acts supernaturally in the world. Third, a respect for divine authority. Again, these are your options for the 16th and early 17th century in Europe, Protestant, Catholic, Jew, or Muslim. Everyone believes that God has given us a word, and it is an authoritative word. You must obey it. You must understand it. You must believe it. Your eternal destiny is determined by what you believe about God. And so looking at the 16th and early 17th century, you see a very different world than the one you and I live in right now. Just pick up the newspaper. Just go to the websites. See what people think and how they understand the world around them. They do not see the world as centered on God. They do not see the world around them as one in which things like supernaturalism and the understanding of God acting supernaturally is in fact true and real. Very clear that there is no respect, hardly any, for divine authority and recognizing that God has spoken and we must obey. The 16th and early 17th century, very, very different. And you see it even more through a statement like you find in the Westminster Confession of Faith, chapter 1, paragraph 6. The whole counsel of God concerning all things necessary for His own glory, man's salvation, faith, and life is either expressly set down in Scripture or by good and necessary consequences may be deduced from Scripture. Everything you need to know, everything about God and about what He is doing for salvation, faith, and life, they believed was in Scripture. That's where it was found. That's where you would go to understand your world, yourself, what God is doing in the world. Now again, I can't state this more strongly. That is a very different world than the one you and I live in. That is a world that understood what the Bible is, believed it as a trustworthy word of God, and considered it authoritative in their lives, how they lived, what they did. So what happened? How did we go, particularly in the West, from that view to the one we find today? Many of you who know the history of Western Europe know that the Enlightenment that began in the late 17th century and crashed very hard in the 18th century on the shores of Europe, no question, recalibrated and reconfigured the way Europeans in particular and the impact of that on, I would say, the entire world about how people thought about their life and about their world around them. What did it look like? First, I would say you begin to see by the late 17th century and on into the 18th century, philosophers and others adopting a radically skeptic position, doubting everything, questioning all rituals, all laws, all rules. That questioning began to emerge in a radical way. And of course, in the wake of that questioning, questions about God, about the Bible, about the church. Really? Is that true? I don't think so. Prove it if you want me to believe in it. Prove that God exists. Prove that the Bible is the word of God and the supernatural. Prove that the church is right. And of course, we have to understand, in context, there are some very serious events in Europe that would bring about that kind of skepticism. One of them I can just point to very quickly, that there is no question that by the midpoint of the 17th century on till the end, Europeans were tired of wars of religion. So much bloodshed from the 17th century forward over what you believed about God and the Bible. And it got to a point where I think many said, the Bible is actually more divisive than anything else. Is it really the Word of God? Radical skepticism emerged, and the way forward became the dominance of empiricism. The old world, 16th and 17th century, how do you know things are true? How do you know what you're supposed to do? Read the Bible. Follow God. By the time of the Enlightenment, prove to me. Prove to me that God exists. Prove to me that the Bible is true, that I should follow. And how do you do that? Well, only that which is true is that which I can empirically assess. How do you do that? Can I see it? Can I hear it? Can I touch it? Can I taste it? Then it's true and it's real. Is it rational? Does it make sense to my human mind? Then it's real. And if it doesn't fall into those categories, then I don't believe it, the empiricist says. Skepticism and empiricism as the way forward to understanding truth and that which should be believed. Finally, the Enlightenment period also brought new sciences that would reorient the way people think about the world. Isaac Newton's advances in science, Blaise Pascal in mathematics and other fields began to show Europeans that, wait a minute, there are explanations scientifically for the things that you thought were either supernatural or things that just God did directly or under his providence. No, in fact, we've got very naturalistic ways of explaining the world around us, and we don't need to immediately revert back to some divine being as causing certain things within the world. New sciences, new philosophies, by the 18th century would reshape Europe and leave in its wake radical doubt, disbelief and distrust of the church, and Christianity as a religion, very, very vulnerable and threatened. In the midst of this, one philosopher begins to emerge as a significant thinker who would try and provide a way forward. Immanuel Kant, 1724 to 1804. If you've heard particularly of any of R.C. Sproul's lectures on the history of philosophy or on the history of the Western civilization, he always points to Immanuel Kant as the significant figure that we all must pay attention to. I can hear his raspy Pittsburgh accent in my ears right now about the Kantian watershed. And that this moment was so dramatic because of what he proposed. Immanuel Kant looked at all this skepticism and all this empiricism, particularly the writings of David Hume, in which he described, it awoke him from his dogmatic slumber. All of a sudden, I see clearly. And he concluded that if we're going to move forward with a place for religion and for God, we need to understand the categories of the world properly. And so Kant proposed a distinction, what he described as the noumenal and phenomenal realms. Kant said the noumenal, that's the thing in of itself, true reality, that's God in the spiritual world. That's a good thing. We should acknowledge that such things exist. But we should distinguish the noumenal from the phenomenal. That's the physical world. That's the world you and I live in now. And you cannot move from the phenomenal to the noumenal. What was Kant trying to do? If I would give Kant the benefit of the doubt, I think he was trying to protect a place for religion and for God. All of these doubts, all of these skeptics, all of these scientists tearing apart all the old world views that were centered on God, he said, now wait a minute. Let's make a distinction. The noumenal world where God exists and spiritual things, let's bracket that. Those things are beyond human experience. But the phenomenal world, the world you and I live in, with all of the science that's going on in it, with all of the discoveries, hey, we can explore that by human experience to its extent. All of the empirical methods, all of the scientific methods, all the rational methods, absolutely. In the phenomenal world, those are useful tools, useful methods. Apply them thoroughly. But you can never move from that phenomenal world to proving or disproving the noumenal. It is beyond experience. It is suprarational. In a certain way, there's some logic to that. It's kind of ingenious to think, wow, that's it. He's protected God. He's protected a place for religion in which all of the Enlightenment philosophers and scientists can no longer attack and touch God. Because Kant has said, you can't move from phenomenal to the noumenal. Problem. For traditional Christians, of course we believe in God. And of course we believe God is transcendent and above our world. But at the same time, we believe that God has come down and God has revealed himself. And the final place that he has revealed himself and given a revelation to us is in the Bible. Now, is the Bible phenomenal or noumenal? Following Kant, many theologians of the higher critical study of Scripture that come from much of the German tradition at that time concluded, well, the Bible's a book. It's got human authors. It's got histories and dates there. It talks about cultures and experiences. It's got to be phenomenal. It's talking about human history and what happened, and therefore it is subject to all the rational empirical tests of the phenomenal world. Let's test it. Does it really give us an accurate history? Let's test it. These so-called miracles, maybe they're just early myths and superstitions, and they're really not what happened because you can't really prove those things. Let's test the Bible against our empirical and scientific methods. And once we've done that, we can determine which parts are true and which parts are false. What Kant did in terms of an attempt to protect a place for God, I would argue, opened the door for those following after him to look at the Bible and say, well, according to Kant's categories, that is phenomenal and therefore subject to all the tests and scientific examinations that we should apply to any other book that's been written in the history of the human race. It's no different because it's part of the phenomenal world. So the Bible as phenomenon became now the direction in which European theologians would study God's holy word. And we really move from an understanding of Holy Scripture to the study of the Bible. And do you notice that when you read a lot of, I would say, general literature about the Bible, do you notice that they always now write the Bible in lowercase, B-I-B-L-E, and it's a lowercase Bible? It distinguishes that this is just like any other book now to be studied and examined, versus if you go to 16th and 17th century writings, it's always Holy Scripture, capitalized H-S, unique, distinct. Not anymore. And the higher critical study of Scripture then begins to deconstruct the Bible. Things like source criticism. Well, what are the original sources of the Bible? What were the things that these human authors were using, and what were the things that shaped them in their own history to construct and then write different parts of the Bible? Form criticism, to reconstruct, well, what did those authors really mean when they wrote these words in the Bible? What was really behind their words? And how do we decipher what is true and what is in fact just either myths or superstitions? Redaction criticism as well, reconstructing the history of how the certain books were written. Perhaps there were others later on that adjusted and decided to change things within the Bible. All this was part of the higher critical study of the Bible that came out of the Enlightenment. In the midst of all of this, certain Christians, though, looked at what was coming out of Germany and began to respond in some very, very significant ways. And I want to spend a good amount of the rest of our time this evening looking at one in particular, Benjamin Breckinridge Warfield, often known as the Lion of Princeton Seminary, and his contribution to what would be really the doctrine of Scripture for Reformed and Evangelical Christians and the doctrine of inerrancy more specifically. B.B. Warfield is, without question, one of the most exceptional theologians of the Princeton theological tradition in the 19th century. And if you look at his writings in particular, you'll see that he covers a number of different subjects, but was very much focused on the doctrine of Scripture in response to the higher critical studies that he had experienced and continued to wrestle with in his career. A little bit of background about Warfield. Warfield was born in 1851 to a wealthy and famous Kentucky family. He had relatives who were successful military officers, educators, businessmen, political figures. He even had one relative who was vice president of the United States. And really, he had a very privileged life. Good education, went and did his undergraduate studies at the College of New Jersey, which is today's Princeton University. And then after graduating, his father sent him to Europe to study for a while. He went to the University of Edinburgh in Scotland and to Heidelberg. And riding home from that trip, he told his family that he felt this call to full-time Christian ministry, that he would commit himself now to the work of the gospel. In 1873, he enrolled at Princeton Seminary, graduating 3 years later and marrying the daughter of a prominent Lexington attorney, Anne Kincaid. It's a very, very touching story that later on in their marriage, Anne was struck with an illness in which she was basically an invalid, couldn't leave the home. And there's all these stories from Princeton about how devoted he was to his wife, never traveled, never left, always there by her side, a devoted husband all the way through. Warfield went back to Europe after studying at Princeton and then took a position at Western Theological Seminary in Allegheny, Pennsylvania. But in 1888, he was called back to Princeton Theological Seminary, succeeding his own teachers, Charles and A.A. Hodge, as professor of didactic and polemical theology, what we would call today systematic theology and apologetics. And he would serve at Princeton Seminary for 34 years until his death in 1921. Now, I mentioned earlier already that Warfield's writings, particularly on the doctrine of Scripture and the doctrine of inerrancy, really were the defining writings that we see impacting the Reformed and Evangelical Church to this day. If you go to any of the major evangelical seminaries, most of them in their first year courses in which they teach the doctrine of Scripture, they'll assign something of B.B. Warfield to read because he was that significant and that important. And we'll see as we move forward why that is the case, because he will put his finger on a number of key issues that must be understood and defended during his time as he was fighting for the Bible against these higher critical scholars. And I would say important for our time as well, as we consider still this doctrine and what others are saying, even in our own present time. Well, where does Warfield start? Warfield starts with what he calls the doctrine of inspiration. The doctrine of inspiration, in which Warfield writes, "Inspiration is therefore usually defined as a supernatural influence exerted on the sacred writers by the Spirit of God, by virtue of which their writings are given divine trustworthiness. I want to point out that last phrase to you. Divine trustworthiness. That should immediately point us back to the 16th and 17th century. That Warfield is connected back to that Reformed tradition in which he believed the Bible was divinely trustworthy. You could trust it. You could absolutely depend upon it. You can stake your life on it because it is a trustworthy divine word. Now, he talks about this phrase, inspiration, and he describes how inspiration is this supernatural influence on the sacred writers, those human writers by which the Spirit of God then makes those writings divinely trustworthy. Where does Warfield get this from? Well, his classic proof text, and many of us know this passage, is 2 Timothy 3:16, in which the Apostle Paul writes, "All Scripture is inspired by God, is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work." And Warfield zeroes right in on this word, inspired. The first thing he does is he makes very clear that don't be confused by the English use of this word. When we talk about something as inspiring, what do we usually mean by that in English? You know, if you sit in the concerts here at 10th Presbyterian Church and you hear this beautiful music, oftentimes you walk away and you feel inspired. It motivates you, makes you feel something emotionally, and usually can lead oftentimes to certain actions. Warfield says that's not what the biblical word here means. He looked at the Greek word and he really described this as what it means is not that you are being inspired here, but that the biblical authors are spirating. And what does that mean? It means that they are breathed into by God. The picture is God's breath. When we speak, our breath brings these words forward. And the image is that God is speaking, and it's through these human authors, they are inspired, and the breath of God comes forth now in words that would form Holy Scripture. For Paul, Warfield argues, he is writing about these writers being breathed into by God, and that this inbreathing produces a trustworthy word because it comes from God. In other words, Warfield says, when Paul declares then that every scripture or all scriptures the product of divine breath is God-breathed, he asserts with as much energy as he could employ that scripture is the product of a specifically divine operation. Now earlier I pointed out the phrase divine trustworthiness. It's trustworthy. You can rely upon it. And why? Because it is produced by divine operation. It's supernatural. It is something that comes from God. And immediately what Warfield is saying, Kant, your division between the noumena and the phenomena and how those two realms must always be set apart, Warfield says no. That's absolutely wrong. Destroys it completely and says, in inspiration, God has come and inspired, breathed in and out of these authors to produce something that is trustworthy because it's divine. Because it comes from God. Because it is supernatural. And it is given by God. Warfield points this out and emphasizes Scripture is a divine product. It is supernatural, it comes from God, and it is trustworthy. Now, if it's trustworthy, the next step is to be convinced, or you should be convinced, if it's trustworthy, then you can rely on it, you can believe it, you can follow it, it can be authoritative for you. So trustworthy, authoritative, because it is the divine word of God. And for Warfield then, this is where you begin. This is how you understand what God's word is, to understand that it comes from God, supernatural, trustworthy, and authoritative. Now, if we had more time, I could pull out a number of other biblical passages that Warfield points to. And he's using these biblical texts to demonstrate that the Bible is the supernatural word of God given by divine inspiration. And he goes over and over all these biblical texts to show that. Now, the careful skeptic out there would say, now, wait a minute, Warfield. You want us to believe this Bible is inspired over against all the Enlightenment philosophers and against the higher critical studies, yet your proof for it being inspired is text from within the Bible. That doesn't make any sense. That's very circular. I use this example in my classes all the time. It's like me saying, I'm the best teacher at Westminster Seminary. And you say, well, prove it. How do you know that? Well, because I said it. No. Nobody's going to believe that, right? If you want to know who's the best teacher at Westminster Seminary, you go and read the reviews, you go and listen to the lectures, you go and evaluate, you go and compare Westminster professors with seminary professors from other schools. You do all of this research based on things outside of the statement, I'm the best professor at Westminster. But the Bible is saying it is authoritative and trustworthy, and you are to believe it as authoritative and trustworthy because it says it is. And the skeptic says, no way. No way. That's a circular argument. That can't be believed in that way. Warfield's response was that this is not circular. Warfield actually begins by building these, it's like a building blocks that he tries to stack up, where he begins with defending what is Christian, what is the Christian religion and theological positions, and then moves then to the reliability of Scripture, and then ultimately to the doctrine of inspiration. If we had more time, I would express to you, this is probably where I'm a little bit, how should I describe that? I'd be a little bit critical of Warfield here. Because I would insist the Bible is the most trustworthy, authoritative, truthful word that we have. And if you're going to measure something, right, and demonstrate whether something is true and real, well, you want to use the highest standard to do that. But in this case, there is no higher standard than the Bible itself. And we must approach the Bible not with the skeptic's heart of, wait a minute, this sounds circular. We must approach the Bible by recognizing it is God's word and there is no other standard in this world, scientific, historical, or rational, that can measure the Bible because it is the ultimate standard. We must submit to it. And understand that this is a supernatural word of God, trustworthy and true. Now, Warfield will go on, in which I would agree with him. It is important to engage the skeptic. It is important to discuss these things. It is important to explain these things. But in the end, even Warfield would say, ultimately, it's the Holy Spirit that will ultimately convince someone. Warfield's a Calvinist, no surprise. It is ultimately the Holy Spirit that will use these means to convince someone that the Word of God is true. Now, moving from that understanding of the Bible as inspired, and it's a supernatural act of God that produces this trustworthy divine Word, one might say, now hold on a minute though, but when I look at the Bible, I see these human authors. I see human authors writing there, and they look very, very human. How do we understand that this is a word of God when it's written by human authors? Isn't it just like any other book? Or at the very least, can't we just say, well, you know, the human authors are teaching us good things in there, but why do you insist on the supernatural activity of inspiration? Why do you insist that the product of that must be without error, inerrant? Some have suggested at Warfield's time, well, why don't we just call it all the providence of God? Isn't it the case that we all believe that God providentially oversees all things in this world? And so that these human writers, God providentially oversaw them from the moment they were conceived all the way to the point in which they write Holy Scripture, all of their backgrounds, training, learning, characteristics, it's all under the providence of God, and it produces this Bible that is still valuable, still helpful for us, under God's providence, and we don't have to insist on all of these details being absolutely without error. We don't have to insist on every detail being so specific. We just say it's under the providence of God. Isn't that enough? Why do you have to insist on inspiration and then ultimately inerrancy? Warfield, of course, believed that that would undermine tremendously the doctrine of Scripture as God's Word. Let me draw another example that I use in my classes on this. George was very kind to mention a book that I don't expect anyone in this room to read, and that is my doctoral dissertation. And it is a book that comes out of my own background interests. That I grew up in a tradition in which, and I'll tell you, the doctoral dissertation is basically looking at views of the end times in the 17th century, and I combed through all these old commentaries on the book of Revelation from the 17th century. And one might ask, Jeff, why did you write that dissertation? What was your interest in that? And you can go all the way back and look at my history from the time of growing up in a particular church that I was in that had a particular eschatology or view of the end times that really shaped the way I thought about Christianity as a young Christian at the time. And then going through my undergraduate, which I had a lot of interest in history, I really enjoyed the study of history, and then going to seminary, which I had a radical change in my view of the end times. And that was very dramatic for me, to come to a radical shift in my understanding of the book of Revelation in particular. And then to come to that point where I was thinking about doctoral studies and one professor suggested, well, no one's looked at this area. Jeff, why don't you look at the history of eschatology? I said, great. Combining my interest in history with my interest in eschatology, end times together, and I set off to write this doctoral dissertation. And I produced a dissertation that was eventually kindly published by a publisher. Now, one could look at that and say, all that was under the providence of God. Jeff's early experiences, Jeff's change in theological positions, Jeff's interest in history, Jeff's professor directing him, isn't this all under the providence of God? Absolutely. But the difference is I would never claim that my book is without error. In fact, I've had one scholar already write me and say, you've got a factual error in your book. And you know what? He's right. I looked it up. I made a mistake. And at the same time, I would never argue that my book is absolutely the definitive last word on this subject. In fact, it's been reviewed. Others have pointed out weaknesses there. Others have pointed areas in which it could be improved. All of these things demonstrate that my book is not absolutely trustworthy, nor is it the absolute authority. Yet at the same time, it was brought under divine providence to its publication. Do you see the difference? I would never claim my book to be authoritative and trustworthy, but the Bible claims itself to be that. Without error, trustworthy at every point, and authoritative for us. And Warfield argues, inspiration is that which shows us that this book is different than any others. Warfield goes on to write, the scriptures, in other words, are conceived by the writers of the New Testament as through and through God's book, in every part expressive of his mind, given through men after a fashion which does no violence to their nature as men, and constitutes the book also men's book as well as God's, in every part expressive of the mind of its human authors. Warfield is describing what he calls concursus, meaning that the human and divine authors work together at every point. This is not something that is dictated to the human author, but God does use all the human authors, all their characteristics, all their training. But Warfield goes on to say, the Spirit of God gives the product a divine quality, unattainable by human powers alone. Thus, these books become not merely the word of godly men, but the immediate word of God. Warfield is arguing, absolutely God used human authors. Absolutely under the providence of God, they were prepared to do the work that they were going to do in writing Scripture. But at the moment they begin to write, inspiration now occurs. And what that does is produce a product that is above and beyond anything they could have written on their own. In other words, it's a superhuman product. It is something beyond what these human authors could do on their own. They couldn't have done it on their own. But under inspiration, we have now a book that bears the divine characteristics. Inerrant, trustworthy, and authoritative. Warfield insisted upon this, and this would ultimately be the position of the conservative Protestant church, both Reformed and Evangelicals, in order to now defend against the higher critical studies that were coming from Europe by the 19th century. Now, the principles of Warfield. When we look at Warfield, before we get to the principles of Warfield, let me mention one other thing here, because I think it's important to state that Warfield was not only operating at the doctrinal level of understanding inspiration, but Warfield was also very much interested in what we may call the kind of sticky issues that often those who have challenges or bring challenges against Scripture always point out. For example, when we ask about the Bible as being inerrant, the question always emerges, which Bible are we talking about? Which Bible is inerrant? And when you start to begin to look at what scholars are doing, it's very clear that there are manuscripts and multiple of them that go back very far into the Christian history, that there is a Masoretic text of the Old Testament that Hebrew scribes tried to preserve as they continue to record and make copies of it. And then when you start to begin to kind of compare some of these manuscripts, some would see variations, differences in them. And the question is, well, which, what are we talking about here? The Bible as inerrant. Well, what Bible are we referring to? Warfield's position on this, Warfield argued, well, there is an original, what he called the autographs. There is an original of all the writings of the Old Testament. The original writings that Paul wrote down, the original writings of the prophets of the Old Testament, the original writings of Moses and the Pentateuch. There are original autographs. And Warfield argued those are inspired. The copies that were made, that were handed down through the years, those are human copies, and sometimes there are scribal errors that enter into them. Sometimes there's variations that you see in them. But Warfield argues the original is that which is inspired. Well, that immediately brings up two logical questions that come from that. Where are the originals? And the follow-up question is, well then, wait a minute, were things lost or misunderstood? Do we really have the true Bible today, given these variations? Warfield would argue, we do not have the originals anymore. The original autographs are not in existence anymore. But at the same time, he would argue under the providence of God that these manuscripts and these traditions have preserved the content at that original, and any variation does no theological violence to the message of Scripture and is very, very small when you begin to compare those variations. Warfield argued with confidence that what we have today is, in fact, the Word of God given, though we do not have the originals. Warfield also argued that what you have today then is the necessary and even hard work of what we call textual criticism. By that he means you're comparing the text to try and study and come up what is the best understanding of the original. And he concluded that this does no harm to our view of plenary or full inspiration, and no harm to our understanding of God's word as trustworthy and authoritative. So in the end then, Warfield argued, first, the Bible is a supernatural book written by men inspired by the Holy Spirit. He insisted upon our understanding of the Bible as supernatural over against what Kant and his followers would claim. Second, the Bible is without error because it is God's word and it bears the characteristics of God. God does not err. God does not lie. God does not contradict himself. And therefore, if this is his word, it bears those same characteristics of truthfulness and inerrancy. Finally, because it is inerrant and inspired, once again, the Bible can be a word of God that we trust and that we believe in and that we follow. I'm convinced that Warfield's teachings and writings are as important for us today as it was for the church in the 19th century, and that he's given us a legacy now to remind ourselves of what it means to believe in God's inerrant word, to trust it, to follow it, over against all the things we're seeing in our world today, attacks both inside and outside of the church, those attempting to undermine its trustworthiness, those attempting to demonstrate that this is not something that we should follow and claim as authoritative. It is my hope that as this lecture series continues, you'll be reminded more and more of what we believe as Christians about God's word, and that it would have not just an intellectual understanding for you, but a vitality for you in your life each day to know that God has spoken to us and given his word, and that we can feed upon it each day to continue to direct and guide us and lead us, because it comes from him. Thank you.
Jeff, thank you so much for coming and speaking to us tonight and lecturing on this very important topic. And, you know, it's very thought-provoking and also puts into context how important it is still today, and even more so in terms of the issues that we face and how we carry ourselves as Christians. I first wanted to open up the floor to questions. So feel free, if you have a question, please raise your hand. I will come over to you and you can ask Dr. Drew a question directly.
Be kind, Steve.
Jeff, when you talk about witnessing to a skeptic, and you talked about that circular argument,
yeah.
The Bible is God's authoritative word because it says it's his authoritative word. And we have skeptics in our family that are logical thinkers. If you take them through fulfilled prophecies,
yeah.
What has been prophesied in the Old Testament yeah. has come to fruition in Christ and, you know, historically proven.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, that's an effective way of talking
absolutely.
And witnessing to a skeptic. And then at some point they take the step of faith
yeah.
once they
yeah.
recognize all of the fulfilled prophecy. It's just amazing. It's got to be supernatural if these things happen.
Right. I mean, there's no question that that the Bible evidences itself, and through prophecy and through other ways as well, to demonstrate that what it says is true and that we should believe it. My point earlier, I think, was that, but that is not weighed by some external standard. If we do that, even for the sake of argument, if we did that with an unbeliever, we've undercut a basic belief as Christians that there is no higher standard than God's word. But that doesn't mean, like you're pointing out, there isn't evidence internal to the Bible that demonstrates that it is God's word, like prophecy, in which God speaks to an Old Testament prophet and says, this will come to pass, and it is fulfilled. Absolutely. Absolutely.
Additional questions?
Hi. Thanks so much for giving this great talk. I guess my question is, in your opinion, or in the Reformed tradition, what is the proper place of reason
yeah.
in the context of faith? First of all, you're preaching to the choir. I personally believe all the things you're pointing out. But there were just a couple things I want to bring up as coming from the viewpoint of reason.
Yeah.
I was witnessing to a Muslim the other day, and he was talking about how the inclusion or deselection of certain books of the Old Testament during the Council of Nicaea was extremely politically motivated. And I'd read something along those terms by H.A. Drake, Constantine and the Bishops. So I could speak to him, but he was saying, you know, we Muslims believe every single word, every jot and tittle, is the word of God, whereas for you Christians, you can deselect books and include books, and for you, it's just politics.
Right.
I had nothing to say. And then secondly, basically, you had addressed it, but I mean, really, for me, as someone who loves history, it's very difficult to accept that we're not allowed to ask or go back to sources as to certain heart motives of certain junctures in history. Why did that happen?
Good question. I mean, particularly when you're talking to Muslims, the sticky questions that I was talking about just briefly before, it's very easy for them. They're convinced the Quran was dictated by God to Muhammad, supernaturally. It's not Muhammad's words at all. Angel comes and gives it to him, he writes it down, that's it. And so that's why, of course, you know, in the Muslim tradition, you have, if you're a true Muslim, you've got to learn Arabic, because you can't even translate it. That word comes from God directly in that way. Now, the point that you make about the kind of dirty process of history, I'm calling it that, you know, that people often point to, and you cited something that, of course, you know, the popular author, I'll call him, Dan Brown, has made a lot about, is in terms of this sort of early history of Christianity, when these councils had all these political maneuvers, Machiavellian kind of methods of trying to exert power and then ultimately control things like which books are put into the Bible. Fascinating new book that's come out by a classmate of mine, Michael Kruger, who is the president of RTS, Reformed Theological Seminary in Charlotte, has written this great book that gets right at these issues, in which he is historically arguing, I'm convinced, that was never the case at all. That what you have is a development happening in the early church, in which Christians begin to recognize these writings as authoritative. And it doesn't happen overnight, and it doesn't happen like, oh, one day everyone votes on it. It is something that develops, and you see this as early as apostles quoting each other as authoritative, and moving all the way through to the point of the second century, in which you do have a canon or a New Testament order that the church begins to accept. Now, the skeptic and even the Muslim will look at that and go, well, but that's so human and messy still. How do you know you did the right thing in your history back then? This is where Warfield, and I'm convinced that we have to insist, our God is a providential God. He gives to his church and preserves for his church what he wants his church to have. Now, behind that is a presupposition that you believe that God is providentially overseeing all of history, that it's not up to the choices of individuals autonomously. If that is the case, then we must approach God with confidence that what he's given us is what he wants us to have. And I know that's not the most persuasive argument, particularly for those in my field in history, where everything also is still built on evidence. Prove it historically. Ultimately, I have to submit my historical understanding to God as well, too. That he is in control of all things from beginning to end, including history. And that my examination of history is not an examination that is just neutral, rational in the sense of rationalistic, meaning I don't allow for anything unexplainable to come into my understanding. Even that I have to submit to God, because God's work doesn't end when the Bible is done being written. It's his preservation that continues to the church even today. And I know that for a lot of skeptics, that's not a good answer. But at the same time, I think there is good historical work that shows what the church was doing in the early period, recognizing. And again, I cannot help but allow my theology to undergird my understanding of history as well. Because if I'm convinced that only the Spirit is the one who would convince me to believe in God's word, that same Spirit is causing the church to recognize God's word, even in the formation of the New Testament, recognizing God's word. It's the same work of the Spirit. It's the same Spirit who inspired these authors to begin with. It's the same Spirit that calls us to be united to Christ. It's the same Spirit that works within the church to recognize the voice of God.
Other questions?
Hi, I was just wondering if you could touch on one aspect of Warfield's thought that really wasn't mentioned tonight, but I think is somewhat fascinating in light of, I feel like this lecture series on inerrancy in many ways is responding to what's considered to be current threats against inerrancy, and oftentimes we view sort of science as being a threat against inerrency, and there was sort of a back current of that dealing with the Enlightenment tonight. I was wondering whether you could address Warfield's interaction with science, and yeah. particularly the extent to which interestingly, he seems to at least be open to, and at some points in his career, accepting of the theory of evolution as being entirely compatible with inerrancy, and using sort of the book of nature as a source for interpreting the book of scripture.
Thanks. Good question, especially because the 19th century, of course, is also still seeing scientific discoveries. At the time Warfield is writing, Darwinism being one of the major issues. The old Princeton theologians, from Charles Hodge all the way down to Warfield and even Machen, thoroughly engaged in science. These guys used to go and sit in the science lectures at Princeton University or the College of New Jersey at that time, interacting with the scientists as well there. And you do see certain openness to some of the scientific theories of their day. I know Hodge much better than I know Warfield on this, but what I've seen in Warfield is very similar. They're open to discussions of macroevolution and change and adaptation. What they weren't open to is the sort of species evolving that moves, say, one species into another, like a primate monkey into a human being. There'd be strong concerns about that in terms of how they would understand that. But there would be an openness, and part of that openness, I would argue, is because of their understanding that, and this goes all the way back to Calvin, God has given us really two books, the book of Scripture and the book of nature, which is creation and what goes on in the world. And rightly understood, we should not be threatened by science. And so they were very open to listen and discuss, but always with that understanding, as Calvin had it also, the book of Scripture is that which measures the book of science, or that which interprets, or that which is authoritative over. So that things that would contradict Scripture, they would have some serious issues with and concerns about. But other things, they would be very open to discussing, looking at, and studying that. And I do think that this is important to understand. And one of my old systematic theology professors stated it this way, that when you're doing this work, particularly those who are interested in the sciences, and you see and you're looking at scientific discoveries and you're looking at God's word, at the very least with scientific discoveries, they do not govern our understanding of God's word. In other words, our understanding of God's word governs our science. But at the same time, our science at points can make us check ourselves theologically. In other words, make you think, okay, now let me make sure that I understand the theology right, because science seems to be saying something here that I need to pay attention to. But the priority is always on God's word, Scripture. But at the same time, it doesn't have to be in competition or in conflict with science, rightly understood. And what I mean by rightly understood, always with that eye to understanding what our theology is teaching us and telling us from God's word in relationship to science. And then also with that ability to say, wow, this scientific discovery, I need to go back and at least double check my Scripture on it, and allow that dialogue still to happen as well, even though the priority is on Scripture as that which is ultimately authoritative. Do the Princetonians balance that well? Here again, I'm putting my cards on the table. I'm not sure they always do. I'm not sure that they always balance that well, and so that you do have this interest in science that at certain points I may personally be a little more critical to say that they've given too much in certain areas. And I think we've always got to balance that depending upon which issue we're looking at, even in our day and age when we have definitely many more scientific discoveries than they did in the 19th century.
So, two questions here that are somewhat interrelated. The first question, where and in what ways do you see the full inspiration
truthfulness and authority of the Bible being attacked or weakened in the church today? Mm-hmm. And then the follow-up question would be, can you extrapolate for us some concerns or dangers of Christians not believing the word is inerrant? So why does this matter to us as a lay Christian?
Yeah. Yeah. I think there's no question that we do see challenges today. We see them everywhere from former evangelical scholars like Bart Ehrman at the University of North Carolina, Chapel Hill. He's got a book called Misquoting Jesus, and he's constantly going back and saying, you know, the history has been misunderstood, and what we have today is not what you evangelicals call this inerrant scripture. And Michael Kruger, who I mentioned earlier, a lot of his work has been directed at responding to the attacks of those like Bart Ehrman, who are trying, once again, to undercut issues of scripture in terms of historicity. I think the other side also, there's some more subtler approaches that are starting to eat away or erode our doctrine of inerrancy. And a lot of that has to do with what we're seeing kind of as the direction of biblical studies today, where there's a lot of comparative work going on right now. What do I mean by that? If you're an Old Testament scholar, there's a lot of work going on in comparing the Bible to other ancient Near Eastern books and artifacts. And oftentimes the conclusion is, wow, look, the Bible is very similar. These books and other things, they have creation accounts that look like the Bible. They have flood accounts that look like what happened to Noah. Maybe the Bible's not so unique and not so distinct when you see these other ancient books. In the New Testament context, the same thing is going on. They're looking at what other Jewish rabbis were writing and saying during the time of the apostles and saying, well, look, maybe Paul's not so unique. Maybe what he's doing is not so different, because when you compare him to the other rabbis, wow, he looks a lot like them, and he speaks a lot like them, and he uses concepts that are very similar to them, and maybe that's not so unique as well. Let me give you one very pointed example of what I'm describing here. There are some New Testament scholars saying, you know what, you Protestants with your doctrine of justification by faith alone, you know what that is? That's Lutheran psychology. That's Martin Luther coming in the 1517, reading the apostles, Paul's work in Romans and Galatians, and kind of basically imposing his own concerns on the text, because he's coming out of this Roman Catholic background where it's all this works righteousness, and he reads that into the text, but that's never what Paul really said. That's never what Paul really meant by justification in his books like Romans and Galatians. And these New Testament scholars are coming to that conclusion because they're taking Paul and they're comparing him to other rabbis during the time that Paul was writing, and they use terms like justification too, but they never mean it in the way Luther meant it. They don't talk about it like Luther. They don't talk about it as individual justification. They talk about it like communally, about the entire Israel, and things like that that are much more communal. And they say, well, that's probably what Paul meant, because he's a rabbi like these other rabbis. And if that's how they're using the word justification, then Paul must be using it as well. And what Luther is doing is he's reading into Paul his own angst with the Roman Catholic Church. Problem. There's no question Paul has similarities with other rabbis around him, but there's one big difference. And that big difference is what Warfield put his finger on. Out of all those rabbis, Paul is the only one that is inspired. And because he's inspired by the Holy Spirit, his work, Book of Romans, Book of Galatians, is superhuman and can say something that's completely different than what the other rabbis around him are saying. That's what inspiration does. That's how important it is for how we read Scripture, to recognize that God speaks, and it's not just he's speaking in one particular era or one particular point of history, but through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, these words have a abiding significance for eternity. The last part of that question about, well, what does this do for me day to day? This is where I think the rubber really hits the road. You may come to church for different reasons. Maybe it's inspiring in the way that I was talking about earlier in the English language. But if you're going to stake your life on something, if you're going to say, this is what I'm going to commit my life to, It better be worthy of that. It better be truthful and trustworthy. Now, I would say you and I very much include myself in this, we don't always know the stakes of what that means. You ask the early church Christians who went as martyrs to die for their faith. Did they believe that was God's word? Enough to die? Go to other parts of the world right now where Christians are being persecuted and ask them, do you believe enough to put your life down for this? Absolutely. It's very easy for us in America. We're not quite under that level of persecution. But the requirement is still the same. If it is true, if it is without error, if it is authoritative, we obey without question because it comes from our God. And I use this word authoritative a lot. I know it gives a certain connotation, and oftentimes we don't like it, particularly in our culture, I think. But understand, when I describe us as those who would submit to the authority of the word, that was always with the understanding that our God has given this word for us and for our benefit. It is that which is given for our salvation. And it's because of his mercy and grace and love. So I do think it has direct impact on how we live, because we've got to be able to trust that this is God's holy and inerrant word.
Hi, Professor Ju. Just a quick question when you were alluding to a circular argument. Mm-hmm. When skeptics are saying it's a circular argument, are they saying it's epistemologically circular, or are they saying the argument itself is circular? Because if it's the former, I feel like they have a much bigger burden of proof on them. But right, if it's right. The latter, if that is what they're asking, how have Christians, scholars addressed that?
Yeah, I do think it has much more to do with the former, in the sense that when we say that God's word is authoritative and it is the highest standard of authority and it measures all others at this point, how do you know that? How do you know that? I mean, that's ultimately the unbeliever's question. How do you know that? Prove it to me. Show it to me. It's a knowledge question in terms of how they understand that. I'm convinced that for the believer, you cannot stand anywhere else. But the only way of coming to know that, only way of coming to ultimately accept and receive that, is because of God's work of grace in us there. And it's not intended, let me put it this way. I'm not convinced that it's intended as an argument that is supposed to be kind of your linchpin in an apologetic fight to kind of do the death blow against your opponent in defending the faith. I'm convinced it is the starting point that cannot be relinquished at any point for the Christian, that my ultimate standard for measuring anything is God's word, whether you believe it or not. And at that point, we move forward then. Yes, we can provide evidence, we can provide arguments, but we never surrender that position, because to surrender that position is to surrender the heart, I would say, of Christianity itself, in which we recognize who God is first and who we are as creatures. I'm not sure that answers your question. Follow up if it doesn't.
And sorry, I just have one more question. For the first part answer that you gave for the previous question, how prevalent was an understanding of, because you mentioned all these comparative studies that are being done right now, but how prevalent in Paul's time was there an understanding of the resurrection?
When you say how prevalent, do you mean?
Like his Jewish contemporaries.
Right. Yeah. Good question. If you start to look at Paul, there's no question that when you look at the Jews at the time, they were divided in different groups. Right? You see it in the Bible as well. You've got the Pharisees, you've got Sadducees, you've got others. And there were some who believed in a resurrection. Paul's group, in fact, as Pharisees. And that was the defining point between him, Pharisees, and Sadducees. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection. Paul's understanding of the resurrection, though, was one in which it would occur at the end of human history. That when you saw resurrection, you saw the end of human history, you saw God coming now to save his people who, for them, was Israel. Right? And I would argue that's actually what reorients Paul's mind when he sees the risen Savior. Resurrection that he thought would happen at the end of history happens in his time. And he's face to face with what he thought was going to be at the end of time, but is in front of him. Changes him dramatically, obviously. That. So there is an understanding of resurrection going on, even amongst the Jews. Whether or not it's the understanding of Jesus as the one who's resurrected, now that's contested there. Yeah.
Dan, I just picked up. You mentioned that, like some scholars have said, that amongst rabbis who were contemporary with Paul, there was, you know, they were talking about similar things.
Yeah.
And I guess my question is, was there, and then you said like the difference is that Paul is divinely inspired. Mm-hmm. Was there also different theology, I guess? Is there a, and I think you just touched on that, but is there also like a demarcation between, let's say, the things that Paul claims that are possible through Jesus and what they claim in to that?
Oh, yeah, yeah. I mean, there's no question. You look across the rabbinic literature of the period, we call it the Second Temple Jewish period. That's what scholars are describing as. Oh, they've got all kinds of theologies there. They've got a theology of the end times. They've got a theology of salvation. They've got a theology of some of resurrection. Yeah, you read the literature, and they are trying to wrestle with their religion and developing their own theologies out of that over various topics, many topics, absolutely. Yeah, that is present at that time. No, you don't see other rabbis saying the same thing. Now, you see other apostles, no question about it. What Paul's doing is he's absolutely situating himself when he describes himself as an apostle with the other apostles, with what they are writing, with what they're saying, with the message they're giving, and distinguishing himself now from his former life as a rabbi and what they are saying. That's very clear in Paul's mind what he's doing there. And I see no evidence, and again, I'm not a New Testament scholar, but at least what I've looked, I've seen no evidence of someone with the same message as Paul writing outside of the apostolic tradition that the early Christians were a part of at the time.
Thanks. I guess just real quick, I wanted to go back to the question about science. I thought it was a good one, and if I heard you correctly, your response focused on the degree to which faith can interact with science.
Yeah.
I guess in terms of this topic, though, inerrancy, for people that have an understanding of what science says versus what the Bible says, mm-hmm. And read, for example, the creation story and say, well, that cannot be true.
Right.
Then how do you get to inerrancy for them?
Right. It's a question of, you'll look at... You'll look even within the Christian church and within the denominations that we have, there isn't one position. And here I'm trying to be careful about how to address this because it is contested even in the churches. Take the creation story. You have some who would say that's a literal 24-hour day, six-day creation. You have some would say, oh no, the days describe long periods of time. You have some who would hold, well, no, it's actually a much more of a literary structure going on in Genesis. It's not intended to give a chronology, strict chronology in that way. And there are various views there. I'll be honest. Some views fit better with certain scientific discoveries than others as well. And I think it's a careful work that must be done to examine the biblical text and at the same time also to recognize that God has created all things, and in creation too, in the study of creation, there are truths there also that can be gleaned, and that ultimately the two are not in conflict. They may be in conflict in our mind and our understanding, but they're ultimately not, because they both come from God. And the difficulty there is finding out, okay, how do we fit this together? And I'm no scientist, or is this my primary area of study to have all the answers? But I do see, particularly to take as an example, There are positions that I would consider orthodox positions on Genesis and creation that allow for an old earth, for example, that matches more of the geological records that we're seeing out there. There are some who would even describe the flood as a localized flood, and I still consider these orthodox positions, and that accounts for some of the historical studies that have gone into, is it really possible that the entire globe was underwater? And scientists have questioned that. There are issues also that go back into the Genesis account as well in terms of the order of certain things that were created and how they naturally occur as we see them today in normal creation, and whether or not they must be ascribed to some supernatural event or a more providential natural event. There are positions that I would say are orthodox positions that do take into account, if I could put it this way, that scientific data that may not always be so accepted by others, if I put it, yeah. But that's careful work that needs to be done, I'm convinced, but necessary work at the same time, because God has given both creation and the book of nature and his holy word.
Thanks, Jeff, for your lecture. Let me ask you a quick question. Is it necessary for a person to believe in inerrancy to be a Christian?
I want to be very careful here to say that it is very, very important to understand that God has given us his word, and in his word is the way to salvation. And yet certain people may look at the Bible and not be convinced that every point is absolutely inerrant. Would I take that person and put them in the category of being a non-Christian? I think it would be to the degree in which they hold to that position of the Bible is not inerrant. And I'm being very careful about this, because I don't want to say, for instance, if someone says to me, everything about the New Testament I believe absolutely, the way of salvation is through Jesus Christ, I just think those chronologies in the Old Testament, they're not exact. Do I say you're not a Christian? I want to be careful there for priority. I would want, though, to explore with that person not just the nitty-gritty details of historical accuracy of the Old Testament, but what is underlying a statement like that when truthfulness and absolute conviction and understanding of God's word as a way of salvation, how does that function with potential errors in the Bible? And I would want to go from that point and explore with that person. Are these errors in the way you're describing them, or do they have certain literary functions or certain constructions that are going on there by genre and other things that we can talk about? So I'm not giving you a straight answer, because I want to be very, very careful there to, on one hand, insist that this is such an important doctrine, that as Dr. Boice stated, and I quoted from that absolutely the vitality of the church is important for us to believe that this is God's inerrant word. Yet at the same time, to account for Christians who struggle with it, who ask questions, who are wrestling through that material. If someone says to me directly, yeah, okay, I've done it, I've wrestled through it, I've looked at all that, and you know what? I don't believe it's inerrant, but I'm still a Christian. I still believe in Christ. I have a hard time understanding that person's submission to God based on that. And that's about as far as I'd be comfortable saying right now, because ultimately, you know, and this may be a cop-out answer, I can't judge a person's heart. Only God can. But I do think this is a very, very, and I'll even say essential doctrine to understand it as Christians, because it demonstrates who you are as a creature before your God and your understanding of what his word is and your willingness to rely upon it and to obey it. Very, very important. But at the same time, particularly in the world that I occupy, you know, scholars debate all these nitty-gritty details, and yet at the same time, I want to give the benefit of the doubt
Questions? Again, I want to thank you, Jeff, for coming out tonight and giving us this lecture and for the active and lively Q&A. Thank you, everyone, for being for giving a thought-provoking and instructional talk to us tonight. Thank you, everyone, again. Thank you, Jeff. Before we depart, I just wanted to mention our upcoming Boice Center lectures, and if you want to mark this on your calendars, September 28th, Dr. Vern Poythress will be coming to speak to us. And then in November 4th, and then in November 15th, we have the pleasure of having Dr. Rosera Butterfield coming to give us a talk. So thank you, everyone, again. Have a good night.